Okay, let us start our next lecture. So today we will be speaking about optimization in a relative scale. So this is quite non-standard setting in nonlinear optimization. And okay, this is the program for today. And first of all, let me recall you what kind of complexity results we have already seen in convex optimization. So we will compare them and we will see so the strong points, the weak points. So first of all, so again, so our problem as usual is the simplest one, minimization with a simple set. So everything is good. So F is convex and the set is convex. So also we always assume the existence of the solution of our problem. And our goal is to find the value, the good point, so which means that the point which has small residual in function value with the optimal value. So the first approach which we considered is the black box approach. So where, so the model of the problem was given by an oracle. So at each point, feasible point at the set Q, so we asked Oracle about the information and we received something. It depends on the power of our Oracle. So it can be function value or function and the gradient or function and the Hessian. And using only this information, we were able to construct optimization methods and to analyze the analytical complexity of our problems and our methods. So I just recall you the problem class. So if our function is Lipschitz continuous and n, the dimension of our space of variable, is big enough, then in order to solve our problem, we need this amount of calls of Oracle. So if the gradient is continuous and again the dimension is very big, then the complexity estimate is proportional to 1 over square root of epsilon. And if n is not very big, so it is reasonable, so which means that we can count on the number of steps proportional to the dimension of the space, then the low complexity bound is like that. So it is proportional to the dimension of the space of variable multiplied by the logarithm of 1 over epsilon. So of course this dependence in epsilon is much better than this and even the, this. Okay, so in this table L is always the corresponding Lipschitz constant. Now, so we looked also at interior point methods. For interior point methods, so we have to look inside the black box and construct for standard problem where the objective function is linear, a computable self-concordant barrier with parameter of nu, with barrier parameter nu. And then in this setting, so this nu is the main, let me say, characteristics of the complexity of our problem. And these methods, so they need the number of iterations proportional to square root of the parameter of the barrier. Okay, each iteration is quite difficult. So this is a Newton type iteration. So usually it needs cubic, it has cubic dependence in the dimensions, but still so the convergence is quite good again. So the we have logarithmic dependence on the accuracy. Now, so at the same time, so we have seen, at least we discussed this, that there exists so-called universal barrier for which the value of the parameter is proportional to the dimension of the space. So in principle, therefore, so if we would use this barrier, so we could have here the number of iterations proportional to square root of the dimension. And as we have seen, so this is impossible if we use black box approach, which means that this interior point machinery, polynomial time interior machinery, provides us with some internal information about the oracle. So it is not the black box. It is not the black box theory. And in order to find the corresponding self barrier for our set Q, we need to look inside our feasible set Q and work with components, with the representation of this set and all things like that. So we will violate the black box principle. So this is the reason why here the dependence on the dimension can be much better. But clearly, so this is quite heavy machinery, and the question is, can we do better than interior point methods? Actually, before we answer this question, let us try to think a little bit. So what does it mean, the polynomial time complexity, and do we always need this type of methods, so fast methods. So just about the sense of this approach. So first of all, so the polynomial time methods, the complexity of them depends logarithmically on the accuracy. So it is a polynomial in the dimension, so this typically this is the complexity of one iteration, but multiplied by the logarithm of the accuracy. For other methods, so which we have seen, the gradient type methods, and actually even the second order methods, so we have considered with this cubic regularization, the complexity depends on the polynomial of 1 over epsilon. Yeah, it can be 1 over square root of epsilon or 1 over epsilon square, something like that. Okay, now, of course, this dependence is very weak. And in this sense, so we can achieve any accuracy which we want. So, because each, if you look at the price of each right digit in polynomial time method, so it is constant. So just if multiply epsilon by, divide epsilon by 10, so this results in additional amount of computation. Every right digit is constant, the price of every right digit is constant, therefore we can get as much as we want. Any accuracy is achievable. On the other hand, so just from the general thinking or philosophy, if you want, so it is clear that the higher is the performance of any methods, then the smaller is the class of problems which can be addressed by these methods. So it's just the conservation law, if you want. So if we have something extremely efficient, so this means that it is not very universal. Usually, so the highest efficiency is achieved at quite limited, let me say, field of applications. So, therefore, if we would think more before we start the solution process, and if we understand what is the reasonable accuracy of our problem, then so we can significantly increase the class of efficiently solvable problems. Okay, this is just, of course, a general reasoning, but look actually what we have quite often. So in many situations, if you look at the process of creating the problem, so dimension is not something which is given in advance. So instead, in many situations, so we have a model of our situation, okay, model of our situation, which has certain accuracy. And dimension is the function of this accuracy of the model. And actually, these problems, they are created like that. So first we choose the accuracy of the model, and after that we see what is the dimension of our problem, like in finite elements, or I don't know, in differential equations, or whatever, or in approximation of infinite dimensional, dependencies or like functions and what things like that. So when we discretize a function, first we decide about the step of discretization, and this step of discretization gives us the dimension of the problem. Therefore, actually, so in this case, the accuracy which is reasonable for our problem is also some function, doesn't matter what is this function, of the accuracy of the model. There is no sense to ask for a higher accuracy in the solution of this discretized version, if you want, then so this function of internal accuracy of the model. So this is more or less clear. So if we just invert this function, we see that Xi is a function of epsilon, and this n is also the function of epsilon, some function of epsilon. So therefore, the dimension and the accuracy becomes dependent in this type of problems. And therefore, in this situation, the notion of polynomial time complexity loses any sense, because there is no any reason to fight for this logarithm if we will have, in any case here, the polynomial which depends on the dimension of our problem. So we need to look at everything all together and then so decide so what is the reasonable approach. So maybe so the guys with this polynomial dependence in epsilon, so maybe are not too bad, because finally, so if you look at the computational time, so they have much cheaper iteration and don't think like that. So therefore, well, we should remember that polynomial time methods, it is not the full analog of the most efficient scheme. So in some situations, they are indeed very efficient, but in other situations, so they are maybe not very, very reasonable. Of course, so when we say that this is not too bad, maybe not too bad. Yes, indeed. So, and we have looked also in this direction for methods which can work with this type of problems, and we are considering smoothing technique. So, I just recall you the main idea. So, we use the huge difference in the complexity between the smooth optimization and non-smooth optimization. Yes, if we look at the complexity estimates in terms of dependence on epsilon, this is indeed very big. So if you take 1% accuracy, so here you get 1 over square root of 10 to the minus 2, this is 10, and here it is 10,000. Really very, very big difference. So, and therefore we decided to approximate our primal problem by a smooth one and solve these smooth problems. Okay, for that, so we need to have a model of the objective function. What is this? So we look inside the black box. We say that our function is representable as a maximum of this solution of this adjoint problem. Okay, and so which can be written explicitly. So we minimize of the maximum, so the adjoint problem with maximization of the minimum, we exchange min and max in this problem. And so this adjoint problem so is a kind of dual information what we get about our initial problem. Now, in order to introduce the smooth approximation, we need to introduce the strongly convex function in the adjoint space. Okay, so we have this U, and using the smoothness parameter, so form the smooth approximation of our objective function. So this smooth approximation must be computable, which means that this object and this object must be simple enough. But if we are able to do that, then using the solution of this problem in U, okay, so which is unique since this function is strongly convex, so we can prove the theorem that the resulting function is convex, differentiable, so it has Lipschitz continuous gradient with the constant L of mu, so which is given by the formula. Note that in this approach, again, so we look inside the black box very deeply, so we know everything in all these formulas or characteristics. So we know, for example, this sigma, the parameter of strong convexity of this function, because we are choosing this function ourselves. We can compute the norm of this operator, since so this is our choice how to define the norms in the primal and the dual space, and all things like that. Okay, so for this smoothing technique, so we have therefore the function which approximates our initial non-smooth function up to accuracy mu, and where the Lipschitz constant is proportional to 1 over mu. Therefore, mu should be chosen small enough, so proportional to the desired accuracy of our problem. Now, so what we do with this function? So let us look just at the algorithms which we apply. So we apply the usual fast gradient method. So for which as applied to the smooth version of objective function. So for example, and here we know how to choose the parameter. So again, everything here is known, must be explicit and known. So if we know the number of steps, we know how to choose this smoothing thing. So it depends on the sizes of the primal set, and this is the size of the dual set. And after n iterations of fast gradient method, so we can take the last point of this fast gradient method as approximation for the solution of the primal problem, and for approximation of the adjoint problem, we would just compute explicitly some average of the previous points. Okay, so what we get? So we get perfect results about the small duality gap, so between the primal objective function and dual objective function, which decreases proportionally to 1 over n. So again, so this is usually without looking inside the black box, this is impossible, okay, because we should have here 1 over square root of n. And therefore, this is much more efficient. Now, the corollary, so in order to get epsilon solution, so we know how to choose parameters. I recall you all of that. Okay, I recall you all of that just to look actually at this complexity result. So how many iterations do we need in order to get the accuracy epsilon? So here, what do we have here? So we have accuracy, the norm of the operator, and these two parameters, d1 and d2. And d1 and d2 are the size of the primal and of the dual feasible set. So, and the question is, what happens if d1 and d2 in this formula is big? So what then this complexity estimate can be quite bad, and in many situations, so we don't need the direct control on the solution of the problem. So if we have the norm of the solution of the problem, if we take the function like that, and so our goal is to minimize this function in Rn, okay, then there is no evident reason which tells us, okay, so the norm of our solution is bound by this quantity. It is already something which is not known. It will be more or less, this question will be understandable after the minimization process. Yes, of course, but we cannot predict in advance how many iterations do we need in order to get epsilon solution of the problem. And this is bad, actually, because again, so it means that if we are lucky and the solution has small norm, so we will find this solution quite quickly. If not, then, okay, so nobody knows. So therefore, today, we will study the following possibility. So in this function, so we see that from construction, so its optimal value is strictly positive, just because it's sum of absolute value, so it cannot be negative. Therefore, we can try to find an approximate solution of our problem in relative scale. Okay? So which means that we need to find the problem, the function, which is smaller than the optimal solution, optimal value of our problem, multiplied by a quantity which is a little bit bigger than 1. So this delta is called relative accuracy. Of course, this guy is bigger than f star, but from above, so we want to have this bounds. Note that this bound actually should be valid independently on the actual optimal value of the function. So we don't know the optimal value in advance, but okay, whatever it is, we want to have this solution with relative accuracy. Note that this concept of relative accuracy is actually very popular in many fields. So we can think about engineering, okay, where engineers, they think always in persons, so which is relative accuracy. In economic also, so people also think, at least on macroeconomic and all things like that, very often in terms of persons, and persons are the relative accuracy. Therefore, okay, so this type of solution is interesting. So, but the problem is that the standard optimization theory, so what we have seen in all previous lectures, so is developed for the absolute accuracy, when we say that the residual on function value is smaller than epsilon. So in order to change it for relative accuracy, so we need to do something with our optimization scheme. So therefore, we need, in some sense, a new model of our problem. And this model must ensure the positivity of the optimal solution, because relative accuracy, it has sense only when the optimal solution of our problem is positive. Okay, so this is the motivation, this is the reason. So why we come to a specific class of unconstrained minimization problems, which we call conic. So it is not conic problems which are used in interior point methods. So this is another concept of conic problems and the difference in this unconstrained minimization problem. So let us look what is it. In this problem, so our objective function has a very special form, and for constraints is also special. Just for simplicity, we say that we have the constraint, a system of linear equations, such that the right-hand side is not equal to zero. This means that this subspace doesn't contain the origin. Origin is not inside. Now, what is our function f? Function f is a convex homogeneous function, a positively homogeneous function of degree 1. Okay, so what is it? So this typically you should see in the course of Spirko somehow, but typically these functions can be written as a maximum of linear functions subject to the constraint in S. Okay, so we give the direction x, and we maximize so this linear form in S. Then clearly our main assumption, so you will see that in a second, is that zero belongs to the interior of this set Q. And the consequence is, so the consequence is that f of x is strictly greater than zero for x, which is different from origin. From viewpoint of convex analysis, so this set Q is exactly the subdifferential of this function at zero. Okay. So I think this is clear. So this, since S is inside this set Q, so this value is bigger than 0 multiplied by X. And since this is interior point, so we can always always increase the value of the objective function. Yes?
Is it if and only if F is a convex homogeneous of degree 1, it is a support function of some set?
of some set, yes.
So
yes.
It is if and only if.
This is if and only if this function is defined on the whole subspace. Okay, so a dom of F. Okay. There are some strange function convex homogeneous. So we have seen them already, like x squared divided by y. Okay, when y is positive. So, but if the domain is the whole space, then this is if and only if. Now, so this is exactly the remark which we have here. So in principle, so don't be confused by this homogeneity. Okay, because any minimization problem can be written somehow in homogeneous form. How we can do that? So we introduce an additional projective variable tau, which must be positive, and we form our function in this form. So t phi of y divided by tau. So from the viewpoint of from geometrical viewpoint, what we are doing? So we take the graph of our function, okay, and draw it in the horizontal plane, which corresponds to the value tau equal to 1. And after that, so we do the conic hull of the epigraph, okay, along these lines. And this is 0. This is tau equal to 1. So if tau is equal to 1, okay, then if tau is equal to 1, then of course so we have our initial problem. But if not, so we just move up and down, so along this additional variable tau, which goes in this direction. Okay, so any function, convex function, can be written, transformed in a conic form, and then so formally we have the same setting because we just say that our constraint is tau equal to 1, and that's it. But it is not the problem which we can treat using this relative accuracy, because this condition is not satisfied. Okay. Clearly, this function, so they can be, since this is arbitrary function, the value of this function can be negative. Okay, and in our setting, so the value of our function is always positive. Okay, now, in order to describe, let me say, the complexity of our problem, so we need to speak about the sphericity. So what is this? We fix some norm. So this norm is arbitrary, so maybe it is Euclidean, maybe not Euclidean, doesn't matter. And after that, so we define two values, gamma 1 and gamma 0, such that the ball of radius gamma 0 in the dual space, so the dual norm, so I recall you what is it, the dual norm, so which is used for gradients, just the maximum Sx subject to the norm of x less or equal to 1. So the ball in the dual space with this dual norm, okay, which means that the norm of these dual variables must be bounded by gamma 0, must be inside this guy, subdifferential. And the ball with radius gamma 1 must contain the subdifferential. Okay, let us write it here, B of gamma 0 is inside Q, and B of gamma 1 contains Q. Using these two balls, okay, we define the coefficient alpha. Coefficient alpha will be very important for our analysis. So this is gamma 0 divided by gamma 1, which is strictly smaller than 1. This will be the main characteristic of the complexity of our problem. Fine. Now, so for ellipsoid, what we know about the possible values of this coefficient alpha? Actually, there is John theorem, which tells us something about the ellipsoidal norm. So norms which are Euclidean. So in view of John theorem, okay, so for any set, so we can find an ellipsoid which is inside of our set, such that the ellipsoid with increasing radius, okay, so in n times, so contains our set. So in this sense, so by shifting the center of our ellipsoid, we can always achieve the sphericity greater than 1 over n. Okay. This is the main John theorem. But there is a special variant of this theorem for symmetric set. So if the set is symmetric, then of course the center of the ellipsoid which is inside is natural to take 0, then this radius can be of the order square root of n. Then in our notation, alpha is bigger 1 over square root of n. So this is alpha 1 over square root of n, here alpha 1 over n. So what we know also about these things, so some bounds on the asphericity can come from the theory of self-concordant barriers. Okay, so the self-concordant barriers, so assume that we have a set with self-concordant barrier psi, and let us assume that 0 is self-concordant barrier for our subdifferential, so for our set Q. Okay. And let us assume that 0 is so-called the analytic center of this barrier. So we didn't look actually at this effect at all because we have not had no enough time. But actually, this is like this. So we have a barrier psi of x. Okay, we minimize it. So in this set, so it is called x psi. So the minimal of the barrier. Then here we can draw the Dedekind ellipsoid, which is defined by psi 2 prime of x star. And we know that this ellipsoid so is contained in our feasible set. What we didn't discuss actually is that there is an enlargement of this ellipsoid in the radius, so by the factor which depends on our barrier parameter, so this, such that this ellipsoid contains our feasible set. Okay, and very often actually, so this characteristics is better than the characteristics which come from the geometry, n-dimensional geometry, because the parameters of self-concordant barriers, sometimes they are much smaller than the dimension of the space. Okay, therefore, in some situations, so this metric which comes from the Hessian of self-concordant barrier at the analytic center, and the analytic center is useful. So we can define, so you see these norms, the primal and dual norms, so in this way. Okay, now let us look at one more example, because again, so this thing about minimization with relative accuracy, it indeed needs some, let me say, treatment or some work, or maybe preliminary work with this set. Okay, the subdifferential of our homogeneous functions. So, and therefore, so all these facts like this, so they can be useful. Assume we have a function of that type. Okay, so the maximum of linear functions. So note that they are not shifted. So this is there's no constant term. So therefore, at zero, this guy is zero. So this matrix A, which has AI as columns, so it is a long matrix. M is much bigger than N. N is the dimension of X. Okay, assume that this matrix has a full low rank. Now, let us assume actually that summation of these vectors is equal to zero. Sum of these vectors is equal to zero. Then it appears that we can define the norm of the primal space using these vectors. And we can write down the bounds on these coefficients, gamma 1 and gamma 2. Gamma 1, so where is it? So gamma 1 can be taken equal to 1. And gamma 0 is proportional to 1 over m. So this simple fact, so let us try to prove that. So we form the matrix, which will be used as the ellipsoidal norm in the primal space in the following way, just summation of rank 1 matrices, AI by AI transpose. So this matrix is positive definite because of this assumption. Therefore, the dual norm can be formed in the following way. So the dual norm is defined by the inverse matrix, okay, the norm of the dual space. Now, let us look at the norm of our vectors, this AI. So we have the situation like this. Okay, in the dual space, in the space of linear functions, we have many vectors AI, like this. Okay. And we know that the sum of them is equal to zero. Therefore, indeed, so conic hull, covers the whole space. So now we introduce here the norm in the dual space. And what we are going to prove is that the corresponding B1 contains all our vectors. B1 means that we look at the vectors with the norm at most 1. So let us estimate the norm of all this AI in this matrix. So how this can be done? So this norm is this. Now, this inverse matrix, multiplication of inverse matrix upon AI and NI can be written as a solution of simple maximization problem. So look what we do. So we write down this quadratic function. We maximize it in X. Okay, so the solution of this maximization problem in X is evident. This is J minus 1 multiplied by AI. Yes, because the solution is JX equal AI. So we need to solve this first order optimality condition for this quadratic maximization. So, and then, so X is equal J minus 1 j minus 1 ai. We substitute it here, and we get this value. So this is simple. Now let us look at this quadratic function. So this jxx can be written, so because of this definition, as a summation of akx squared. So just we define this quadratic function in this way. And so we maximize this construction in x. But of course, so this maximum is smaller than the maximum of the function where we drop all quadratic terms except the term which corresponds to the index I. Yeah, because these terms are non-negative, so we drop it, we get an upper bound. And now we can maximize this upper bound already in x. And this is maximization in one variable, 2 tau minus tau square. If we maximize this, so we get the value equal to 1. So we get that in this matrix, the norm of all our vectors AI are bounded by 1. So gamma 1, so we can take gamma 1 equal to 1. Yeah? So this is the first step. Now, but we need to prove also this inclusion. So how we can do that? So know that, so we have this assumption, this one, the summation of this vector is equal to 0. Okay, this means that summation of ai x is equal to 0. So this is completely equivalent. Therefore, so for any direction x, so this norm of this vector can be estimated from above by the solution of this maximization problem. It is summation of si squared, so we denote by si, so this term. And what we know about this si? So the summation of this si is equal to 0, and all of them are smaller than our objective function, because our objective function is the it is maximum of AIX. So this is a simple maximization problem which we can solve. Let us look in two dimensions, what do we have? Okay, so we have the constraints that S1 plus S2 equal to 0. And we have inequalities constraints, that this is bigger than some positive value. So it is something like this. Okay. This is the diagonal, this is f of x. So S1 is smaller than f of x, S2 is smaller than f of x. So we have this simplex structure, actually, of our feasible set. So if you look, so what is in this intersection, this will be a kind of simplex structure, and we maximize on this simplex structure, so the quadratic function, convex quadratic function. Maximum of convex quadratic function on a bounded convex set or polyhedral is always attained at one of the vertices for this polyhedral. So in this situation, actually, all these vertices are equivalent. So let us look at any of them. So what is it? So when we have this vertex, it is the vector of all ones minus me1. Okay, so this is the edge. So if you look at this sum of the coefficients of this vector, it is equal to 0. So the constraint is satisfied. Multiply by this f of x. So this is the solution of this optimization problem, and therefore we prove that this inequality. Okay, so if we substitute it here, so we get this upper bound for the squared norm of our function. So this means, okay, so that f of x grows at least in this way, and this means that the ball in the dual space with the radius 1 over square root of m, m minus 1, so there is a bracket here, so it is contained in our subdifferential. It is contained in our subdifferential. This is it. So we, in this situation, which actually is useful in many cases, so we can form the ellipsoidal norm, so with a sphericity proportional to m. M is the number of inequalities. Yes.
Excuse me, Anna. How does it follow from this last inequality and the conclusion about this?
Because of that. Okay. If you have here a ball of the radius r, then the maximum of this stuff will be bigger than r multiplied by the corresponding norm. Okay, so if there is a ball here of the radius r, this maximization will be equal r multiplied by the norm of x. So this r gives us the radius of ellipsoid, so which is contained in this set. Yeah. Okay, so we have this pair of ellipsoids. And actually, for this lecture, this will be indeed the main thing. So we will try always to find so this ellipsoidal norm, which approximates somehow the subdifferential of our function at zero. Fine. Now, so besides this norm, actually, so there is one characteristic of our problem, which is important. Okay. So this is projection of the origin on our projection of the origin and our feasible set. So again, our problem is minimization f of x such that cx equal to b in x. So then let us draw what do we have. We have zero, the origin, and our function is positive, so it grows in all positive directions, so from the origin. And now somewhere we have these constraints, cx equal to b, linear constraint. Now, so what we are doing, we minimize our norm on this subspace and we get the point x0. And this distance is rho. So we assume that our norms are simple enough in order to solve this problem exactly. Okay. So theorem. So there are several statements which we need to prove. So first is that, first of all, so from our assumption, so from this assumption, so we have two side bounds for the growth of our function. Okay. And therefore, as we will see, gamma 1 can be chosen as a Lipschitz constant for our function f. And also, there is this long inequality, so I write it down because we will use it many times in different places. Alpha f of x 0 less or equal gamma 0 norm of x 0 less or equal f star less or equal f of x 0 less or equal gamma 1 norm of x0. This long inequality, which in fact explains our abilities of approximating, of finding the approximate solution in relative scale. Just because in this framework, okay, from this simple projection, so it appears that we already have an upper and the lower bounds for the optimal value of our problem. And this upper and lower bound is related to the norm of the projection. Okay, and so this will be also useful. This is a simple consequence. The distance to the optimum is estimated like this, 1 gamma 0 f star less or equal to gamma 0 f of x0. Okay, so for Euclidean norm, so this estimate is a little bit better, so we don't have this coefficient 2. Let us prove this. So again, so this is the first statement. Since f of x is the maximum of linear function or this subdifferential, then of course it is bigger than the maximum taken over the ball, with this ball, which is inside Q. Okay, and this is exactly gamma zero multiplied by norm of x. So we have this bound for the growth of function. So for upper bound is the same. So this maximum is smaller than this maximization, which we know exactly what it is. And therefore, so if we look, so what happens with the function value? Our function is homogeneous, so degree 1, and it is convex. Therefore, just think that we divided here by 2, then here we have coefficient 1/2, coefficient 1/2. So this is just convexity and homogeneity, so the reason for this inequality. Now, we know that this is smaller than gamma 1 multiplied by norm of h, and this means that our function is Lipschitz continuous in this norm with the Lipschitz constant gamma 1. Now, let us look at the solution of our main problem. So this one, Then, since we have this lower bound for the value of the functions, f of x is bigger gamma 0 than x, then so we get this inequality here. So we have lower bound for the optimal value of our problem in terms of the coefficients gamma 0 and rho, the distance to this plane. Okay, and then from this inequality already, we can write down that this is bigger than alpha multiplied by f of x0. Okay, this will be also important. F star greater than alpha f of x0. So it is already written. Okay, and the same story with the upper bound. F star is smaller than f of x0. Now, f of x0 is smaller gamma 1 multiplied by x0. So therefore, we proved all inequalities in this line. Now, the distance from x0 will be always the starting point for our minimization process, which we will apply in this feasible set. Okay, therefore, for us it is important to see the upper bound for the distance from x0 to x star. Look what happens. This difference is smaller than the sum of these norms, and both of them actually are smaller than 1 over gamma 0 multiplied by f star. So this is from this inequality. So therefore, using f star, we have a good bound. So before, look what is the difference with this standard thing. So before, we were able to estimate somehow f star using the strong convexity. Here, instead of strong convexity, so we have homogeneity. And we have, in some sense, much better bound. Because from this inequality, so we know an upper bound for the distance to the optimum, but this upper bound, of course, is smaller than can be replaced by value of our function at any feasible point, because this is smaller than f of x at any x. So there, and we will use that. So we will have, in this sense, the good upper bound to the distance to the optimum. And this bound can be a little bit improved using the Euclidean identities. Okay. Now, how we are going to solve our problems? Let us look. So, what can be done? For that, we just apply at the beginning the simplest subgradient method. So, this subgradient method. So, we'll start from this point x zero. So, it will be applied directly to minimization of our function f of x. The only non-triviality is that. Why it is not here? Yeah, so it should work. It should work. It has parameter R. Okay, it has parameter R, which in principle so should be a good estimate to the distance to the optimum. So therefore, in this method, there are two parameters: number of steps. About this, we decide in the beginning and the estimates of the distance to the optimum. Okay, and after n steps, we just stop. Okay, and we say that our output is the best point which we have seen before. So very simple thing. Now, what we can say about the rate of convergence of this method? So we have already looked at this reasoning. So the variation of the difference in the function value between the best point and the optimal solution is bounded by what? Lipschitz constant of the gradient and some estimate of the distance to the optimum, and actually so this step size parameter divided by square root of n. So we had, in the second lecture, so we had the estimates like this. Okay, now. It is clear that in order to have good relative accuracy for this stuff, so this R must be chosen properly. So it must be indeed a good estimate for this distance. So, but we already have something like this. Yeah? We already have something like this. Why we don't use 1 over gamma 0 f of x 0 as this estimate? So let us look. What happens? So, and this is already the theorem. So we need to have the relative accuracy delta. Then from this delta, we decide about the number of steps. 1 over alpha 4 delta squares. And then we apply this algorithm with these estimates for the distance to the optimum. The result then is like this. So we get the solution with the required relative accuracy. The proof. Proof, as you can see, so is very short, so a couple of lines. So we look at our estimate, efficiency estimate after n steps, and put here n which is 1 over alpha 4 delta square. So square root of 1 over n will give us alpha square and delta. Okay? Now, we have this stuff, so we can use our estimates. Okay, so this guy is smaller than rho hat square, so we have inequalities here, like this. Therefore, it will be 2 rho hat squares divided by 2 rho hat. So it will be just, so after cancellation of 2 and rho hat, it will be just this. Okay, and what is rho hat? This is it. So we substitute it here. We get alpha delta f of x0. And alpha delta alpha f of x0, this is this inequality, is smaller than f star. Yeah?
So we bound x0 minus x star by r also, right?
Rho hat, yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. So this is bounded by that. So this is the reason why we choose it like this. Okay. So and we get so this that we approximate the solution in relative accuracy. So this is the main idea actually is all these schemes. So if you remember, so in the usual methods we have LR, for example, the estimates like this, where R is the distance to the optimum, and now we are able to relate this R star with the optimal value. Okay, so this is of course the simplest and the most inefficient, let me say, the way of doing this stuff, but in principle, so this is the only reason why all of that works. So this is our starting estimate for, yeah?
Shouldn't there be a constant 3 over 2, because we have the inequality that our distance is bounded by, like, if we take a square.
Sorry, where?
Like, we substitute the bound for.
Yeah, sorry. There is one thing which is indeed not very good. So when the norm is Euclidean, so we have in this inequality 1. Okay, therefore for, so there's not reason here. So the for Euclidean norm, this is absolutely true. If the norm, but okay, so this is the most important case. But if the norm is not Euclidean, so you have here coefficient 2, and something should be modified so by a constant. But the reasoning is valid for Euclidean norm. Fine. Now, what is good, what is bad in this result? So the good thing is actually the efficiency estimate. Look at this efficiency estimate. It doesn't depend on anything. It depends only on our delta. And so these coefficients alpha, which we know in advance, and which doesn't depend on the data somehow at all. Okay, there is no norms of some, I don't know, solutions, norm of the matrices or something. We know from the beginning how many steps we need to do. So it's just kind of very, very nice situation. But what is bad actually is dependence on alpha. Alpha to the power 4, this is indeed too much. Fortunately, it is very easy to improve this stuff. So it is, well, the name is a little bit misleading because it is not acceleration in terms of fast gradient methods, but just in our, let me say, strategy of solution of our problem. Now, so what we are doing? So taking into account our parameters, so we choose the number of steps which we are going to do. So in this way, so there is a formula again. So all coefficients are exact. For example, this is the base of exponent, alpha and delta, so you know what is this. Now, we consider the following process. So this is the upper level process. Okay. Now, so this is the upper level process where we run the algorithm which was shown here, so this algorithm, this stuff. So with parameters n and r, we say to this guy how many steps he has to do and what is the estimate of the radius. So this guy is doing exactly n hat steps. After that, we get a point, okay, the output, which was the best point which was generated by this guy. And we look what happens. If our point was not improved significantly with respect to our previous best point in terms of the function value. So E is strictly greater than 1, as you know. Okay, so then we refuse to continue, we stop. If we are not able to improve our function, we stop. But if we were, it was not true, so if we see that the new point which we obtain is smaller than, let me say, something like 1/2 of the previous point, so then we continue. The situation is indeed very unusual, because usually it is just opposite. So this is a kind of situation when we are not going to work too much. So we work only where it is easy to improve the function. So if the function cannot be improved, so we just stop and that's it. So why we are doing this? This is a theorem. First, the number of stages in this process of the upper level is bounded by this amount. This is proportional to the logarithm of 1 over alpha. Again, alpha is this aspheristic coefficient. Now, and when we stop, so this is done. So we get the necessary relative accuracy. Let us look. Yes, and also we can count the total number of gradient steps in this process. So, and this is this. Look, here again, there is no big or something like that. This is an exact number, which depends only on alpha. So in this way. The difference from the previous result is here. In the previous, without this restarting procedure, the complexity was dependent on 1 over alpha to the power of 4. So here we already have something better. It is 1 over alpha squared. Dependence in delta is the same proportional, 1 over delta squared. This is a complexity result. So let us look. So why this is true? So at the beginning of stage T, so intermediate stage T, so this inequality was not satisfied. Therefore, for all previous t, we had the significant decrease of the value of our function. Yeah? So this stopping criterion was not satisfied. Therefore, at each iteration, we were able to reduce the value of our function at least in 2 times. Therefore, so we have this bound. So this actually so is smaller, wait a moment. Yes, so this means that we have this inequality. So this upper bound for the function value, it appears it is bigger, okay, than our last value. So this guy was increased during all previous, decreased during all previous iterations, and this guy, and this is the stopping criterion of the last iteration. Okay, now, this guy, f of hat t minus 1, the guy which was computed here, of course, it cannot be smaller than the optimal value. And the optimal value, again, so this nice inequality, is bigger than alpha multiplied by f of x0. F of x0 cancels, and from this you have the number of stages. So this number of t cannot be too big. But it is more or less evident that this number cannot be too big. So just because of how many times we can divide our function value by 2, clearly it is a short period. Now, why do we have then, so if this stopping criterion works, why do we have this relative accuracy stuff? Let us look. So again, I think here the norms is Euclidean, therefore we have here 1. Okay, so we have this bound for the distance to the optimum. And look, so at each iteration, so iteration which of this process, we update the distance to the optimum. We start from the big estimate, and at each iteration we divide this estimate at least in 2 times. So we make the region where we search smaller and smaller. So let's look what happens. So we have this estimate We started from the same point, x0, projection. So this distance can be estimated by the optimal value. But optimal value, of course, can be estimated from above by this guy. So the point which we have seen at the previous stage. Okay, therefore, the rate of convergence can be bounded in this way. Number of steps multiplied by, okay, so this estimate for the distance, it is here. And here you see the trick. So when the function was not decreased too much, this means that this the function at the previous stage can be estimated from above by the function at the new stage, the last stage. This is exactly this inequality. And then in the left-hand side and in the right-hand side, we have the same values. So substituting here the n-hat, so n-hat was chosen just to have this coefficient equal delta divided by 1 plus delta. And then solving this inequality, so you get the desired relative accuracy. Okay. So therefore, with this, strange restarting procedure, so we are able to solve our problem with much more efficiently. Now, of course, so we already know that so this bad dependence in the accuracy, so in when we are speaking about absolute accuracy, so can be eliminated using the smoothing technique. So can we do the same here? Can we introduce in this model of our function something from smoothing? Okay, smoothing for relative scale. And again, so the answer is yes. And in order to do that, so we need to look at the model, introduce the model of our problem. So of course, there are many possibilities. The possibility which is studied here is like that. So we look inside this function f, the objective function, the constraints are not changing, and we say, so our function f is constructed in this way. It is a simple function, big f, and we put inside a linear image of our point x. And this big f is a homogeneous function of degree 1. Homogeneous function of degree 1. So in principle, so this transformation is linear. Therefore, actually, what we will have here, so we have a kind of non-smooth function, big f of y, which is represented in this way. Okay, our assumption remains the same about the subdifferential. Therefore, so this function value is almost positive. So, and let us do look what we can have with this construction. So let us choose in Rm, again, m is bigger than n. So n is the dimension of x, m is the dimension of y. And in this Rm, we choose Euclidean norm. So we define the ball in this space. And the system of balls, and with these balls, so we define our the same as before. So our constant gamma 0 and gamma 1. Fine. Now, what the norm should be used in our initial for our initial function? Well, it is more or less clear what is it. We need to substitute in this norm, which you use in the big space. So this A transpose X, and this is it. So we get the Euclidean norm for the vector X already. Okay, and then again, consequently, so this is just the consequence of the definition of the norm on this property. So for our function F of X, we have these two side bounds already for this norm. This norm, by the way, is already quite complicated, yes, because here we have linear operator. So with this norm, let us define the projection on the space, the same thing as before. And of course, so all things which we know about the distance to the optimum, so we have discussed this already, so we have this inequality. Again, this one norm, it is not one norm, it is Euclidean norm defined in this way. Okay. So this is a description of our, let me say, initial setting. Now, what we're doing. So in our initial space X, we introduce a restricted feasible set. Our initial feasible set, this hyperplane, was unbounded. So then we intersected with some ball. We intersected with some ball of the radius r. Of course, the radius must be sufficiently big in order to contain the optimal solution. But we are in a very good situation because we know a good estimate for the distance to this solution. Now, and the second step, so we do smoothing in the adjoint space. Yes. So before, in the adjoint space. So before it was just maximization of the set Q. Yes. So here we substitute A transpose X, Y, and we maximize it over the set Q. Now we subtract the square Euclidean norm, and we do smoothing of our objective function. So to this construction, so we apply fast gradient methods, so, and after n steps, we denote by output, so this is the result of this fast gradient method is applied to this smoothing. Okay, now we know what is the efficiency of this method. So if we choose mu proportional, because we decide in advance about the number of steps, we choose nu, we choose Q1 as the restricted feasible set, then so we say what should be the number of steps in this fast gradient method. And again, this is the exact formula. So look that here we already have two advances. We have alpha, it is not alpha square anymore, and we have delta, it is not delta square anymore. Okay, so this number of steps becomes smaller and smaller. So we consider the following process. The same story as above. We decide about number of steps, about the estimates to the distance, we compute the point, and if the function was not decreasing sufficiently, we just stop. Okay? Exactly the same trick. The theorem, same as before, so the number of steps, so big stages here, is bounded by logarithm of 1 over alpha. And so if this happens, then we already get solution with relative accuracy. Total number of steps is, again, bounded by a very nice expression where we even have exact constant, 2 times e divided by alpha and all things like that. Yeah.
And what happens if we don't use restarts in this procedure?
Well, I didn't check, but I think you just square the number of iterations, so the same as before. So here the trick is that if you don't use the restart procedure, then you need to estimate the radius by initial value of the objective function. And this can be quite bad estimate. So here what we are doing, we just update this estimate using the last function value. And that's it. So therefore, the process is much faster. Okay, so I'm not going to prove this statement because it is exactly the same as so what was proved for the gradient method. So we just need to substitute in all these standard estimates for the rate of convergence our constants, and you immediately come to this nice bounds. Now, so let us look at examples. So our problem is maximization of this maximum of absolute values of AI. So we introduce, we look at the subdifferential of this function, maximum of absolute values. So we described it using the Euclidean norm. So the sphericity coefficients are proportional then to square root of m. Okay, and the number of iteration in this situation becomes like this. Square root of m multiplied by 1 over delta and logarithmic factor. Again, so all constants are exact. So each iteration is relatively simple, so it needs all of m times n operations. So we get to this number, complexity bound, for this for solving this problem. Now, let us look at it. So this is the total the total efforts for the optimization process, and this is actually the price of preprocessing. What is the price of preprocessing? So you see we use here this matrix J, which is summation AI transpose. We need to form this matrix, and we need to invert this matrix in order to be able to project on this subspace. So all of that gives you this amount of preliminary work, which in many situations is bigger than the price which we pay for optimization. Okay, and this is actually good for optimization methods because so optimization itself becomes cheap, and preprocessing maybe not. But here, so we can maybe accelerate using the tools of linear algebra or I don't know, sparsity and all things like that. Anyway, these two quantities were, so this doesn't depend on the accuracy at all. And this depends on the accuracy in a nice way. Now it is just only 1 over delta, but the iteration is cheap. Okay, so if you look at the efficiency bound for interior point methods, of course, it relates somehow on the logarithmically on the accuracy, but the coefficients, of course, are much heavier. And actually, there is a switching point when this approach is better than interior point methods. So m divided by n squared must be smaller than delta. But again, so delta, the main advantage of relative accuracy is that it is never small. So people are thinking in terms of persons, or maybe 1/10 of the persons, or maybe, well, but this is more or less, maybe fraction of person, but this is really the limit. Okay, so if you look at the persons which we see in our real life, then the number of persons with two digits after the comma, so this is the only thing which I see, that this is all these banks interest rates which I fixed for 30 years and all things like that. Indeed, very precise accounting. But normally, so this delta should be of the order of 10 to the minus 3 at most. And in many cases, 10 to the minus 2. Yeah.
And why is the sphericity square root of m? It seems like before we had square root of m squared.
We didn't have. This is the next slide, but so here we have this set where we introduce this sphericity in the Rm. This here, this is big F. So in this big, it is in Rm, and therefore the sphericity is square root of m. This is exactly the question which important. Yeah, so what we are going to do in the next slide. Yeah. So is it possible to improve alpha? Indeed, so we are working in n-dimensional space, and it is better to try in n-dimensional space. There are this John business, okay, where we can hope and 1 over square root of n, the small size. So is it possible to improve, indeed, this alpha? Okay, now let's go maybe faster. So all of that I think we have discussed. Yes, so this is John theorem, so about this square root of n for symmetric sets. So can we expect alpha is proportional to 1 over square root of n? And in which cases such a norm is computable? This is the main thing. So we have this description at hand, the description of the differential, but we need to compute somehow this norm. Okay, and the answer is yes. Actually, in some situations we can do that, especially if our set, so this Q, is the conic hull of symmetric collection of the vectors. Okay, we have many vectors like this. We take the conic hull of this stuff, and we want to compute the good rounding ellipsoid. So rounding ellipsoid is exactly like that. So it is contained inside, and if we enlarge it, so we collect, we have all vectors inside. Okay, so the function which corresponds to this situation is just the maximal absolute values of xi. So therefore, q is just the convex hull of plus minus aj. So let us start from simple estimate of this ellipsoid. So we take all matrices aj, aj transpose, divide by m, and this will be our initial norm. So now we need a tolerance parameter, gamma, and this tolerance parameter so tells us, let me say, the quality of this John ellipsoid. You know, from John theorem, we know that this factor can be equal exactly to square root of n. And for our goals, of course, we will be happy if it will be 2 times square root of n. And in this case, so the gamma will be equal to 2. So it is some constant which is bigger than 1, which gives us an accuracy of solution of this rounding problem. Now, the process is as follows. At each iteration, so we come with some matrix J, so the metric, and we look at the norms of all vectors. We just compute all these norms. So if these norms are small enough, so it is bigger than gamma times square root of n, then we just stop, so we have a good ellipsoid. So we are sure that this the unit ball is inside, and okay, so gamma 0 equal to 1, and the gamma 1 is equal, again gamma, okay, yeah, so the gamma 1 is equal gamma square root of n. Then we stop. If it is not, we just change the metric of our ellipsoid. So what is this change? It is just the convex combination of old metric with this guy, which appears to be big. So this process has very nice geometric interpretation. So assume we have a ball, and we look, we find the vector aj, which is small. Or big, minus aj. What we are doing, we look at this body, okay, the convex hull of these vectors plus minus aj, and the ellipsoid, the ball itself. And we introduce the ball. In some sense, we are trying to find the ball of maximal volume, which is contained in this conic hull. Okay, and for this ball, actually the new ball, the bigger one, so there is the exact formula. So it is computed in accordance to this this coefficients. And that's it, actually. Very simple process, indeed. But the theorem is actually that it is very efficient. It is extremely efficient. I would say for me it was really big surprise when you see the formula like that. So the number of steps which is necessary for this algorithm is, roughly speaking, proportional to the dimension of the space. Multiply by logarithm of big M and some constant, but typically, so it is proportional to the dimension of the space. So if you compare, you remember, so we looked at the ellipsoid method. Okay, there the complexity was proportional to n squared. Here it is absolutely perfect. So we need only n rank one correction of this matrix, and you already find very non-trivial objects which describes well your situation. Okay, so the object is like that. The unit ball defined by this metric is inside this convex hull, and if we increase this ball in gamma square root of n times, it will contain so this guy. Okay, and the complexity of each iteration is or mn, so because this is quadratic mainly everywhere. Of course, so for that, so we need to update the estimates of the distances using the fact that our matrix is changed by rank one correction. Then you indeed need only this amount of operations. Now let us look at the idea of the proof, because there are two things. First, we need to say that the unit ball is contained in this conic hull, and the second, so that this complexity estimate. So for the first inclusion, okay, so you we know that actually by this taking the convex hull of the previous matrix with one of rank one matrices of this type, so by these operations we do not change the sum of coefficients for this rank n matrices which are already here. Look, so we start from the representation of J0, where the sum of coefficients for this guy, which is 1 over m, is equal to 1. Yes. Now, if we multiply the old guys which are there, which by 1 minus alpha k, and add alpha k multiplied by this vector, which actually is already somewhere here, so the sum of coefficient is not changing. Sum of coefficient is not changing. And this is sufficient to have the corresponding ball inside this set Q. Okay, let us look why this is true. Let us take psi is equal to delta M and consider the matrix in this form. Okay, then this is more or less it. So we have already seen that. For any vector x, we have this inequality. Just because f of x is the maximal of ai, absolute value a of x, and here there is summation of this guy with the sum of coefficients equal to 1. Therefore, this guy is smaller than the maximum. This is the simple reason. And so we have already discussed that in the beginning. So this means that the dual ball of radius 1 is inside subdifferential of this matrix. Okay. Therefore, if we update our matrices and keeping the sum of the coefficients equal to 1, for sure, so we will have that. Now, and in order to understand what happens with our process in general, so we need to consider the functions, what happens with the determinant of our matrix. So when we update it in this way. And actually, as I said, so we want to maximize this determinant in alpha. Okay, and for that, so we do things we use some knowledge from self-concordant barriers, so we can compute, because minus log z is a self-concordant barrier, so we have seen this. So here we need to maximize it along one line, so we know how to do that actually. So in some sense, so we in dimension one, we implement kind of Newton step, and from this Newton step, so we know how much we increase our objective function. And remember, so there, so in the theory of self-concordant functions, so the increase of the decrease of the value of self-concordant function after one Newton step is proportional to this function omega, so taken in the local norm of the gradient. So if you transform all this machinery, so to this situation, so you can estimate so the progress in this way. And this is exactly sigma, so which tells us that is sigma is big, then the progress is big. Okay, this is an absolute constant. And this is the reason, actually, so why you decrease at each iteration your objective function by a constant. And from this, actually, and the difference in the function value, so of the initial ellipsoid and the optimal one, so you get this estimate for the rate of convergence, proportional to n log m divided by this. Okay, so the process indeed very efficient.
Is it true that this step of this rounding method is just the Newton step for this function?
I think yes, it is a kind of Newton step. Yes, yes.
So it was obtained in this way.
Yes. Of course, you can do a line search if you want. It is not very difficult, but then, so, well, I didn't try this too much. Yeah, so at least with line search anyway, so the justification is that the line search is not worse than this constant step search, and you will get more or less the same. Of course, here line search is also possible. Yeah. Okay. Now, the application. So let's look at our problem, so subject to single linear constraints. So what we're doing now, first we start from finding the rounding norm for this set. For this set, with some tolerance parameter gamma, which maybe is 2, for example. And complexity of this ellipsoid is this. Look how small is it. So after that, phase 2, so using the norm, we solve our problem with relative accuracy delta using the smoothing technique. And this is now the number of iterations of the gradient scheme. Square root of n, not m, divided by delta, multiplied by some logarithm. So in total, we have this very nice estimate for the number of iterations. Okay, so if you look at competitors, so the ellipsoid method, this complexity, of course, with logarithm of 1 over delta, but now it is not even 1 over delta squared, it is just 1 over delta, not very big. So interior point, it is this, again, story, and you see that if delta is not pathologically small, so in all reasonable situations, so this scheme is much better. So we can compare this scheme with the previous scheme. So where we, you remember, we rounded the subdifferential of this maximum of absolute value in Rm, yes? And strangely enough, the complexity of preliminary step there and here is almost the same. So there, so we need to, it was necessary to form this matrix J and to invert that. So therefore, it was mn square also, but once. Here we have mn square logarithm of m times, but still, so it is more or less proportional to this mn square. But as a compensation, so we are able to reduce here the potentially big m in the complexity bound for the number of steps by very nice square root of the dimension. So we have this, finally, the rate of convergence. Okay, so the conclusion is that we discussed a new direction in structural optimization. This is indeed new, and this is optimization in relative scale, so optimization with relative accuracy. So it is even more problem-oriented than our old previous schemes, just because here, so we will see, you will see that it is often that we need some pre-processing before we start the optimization to solve the optimization problems. We need to handle somehow our data to find the good norm and all things like that. So we need a preliminary job, and actually, so this work is maybe more difficult than the optimization itself. So with this relative accuracy in the right metric, so optimization becomes simple. Okay, and the complexity of our algorithms very often, so this is just the square root of the number of operations in black box schemes. Now, all our bounds, they do not depend on the data, which means that we know before we solve the problem, how much time do we need? So there is a simple formula which works always, so and which tells us how many arithmetic operations we need to solve this problem. So therefore, all expenses are very much predictable. And also note that, of course, we do not have the polynomial time method there, so this may be an interesting question. So can we have something like that in polynomial time or not? So, but anyway, so the relative accuracy in all application, it is never very high. It is never 10 to the minus 6 or 10 to the minus 8. So it is very often 10 to minus 2 or 10 to minus 3. Therefore, all our estimates are very optimistic, so because we have low complexity of each iterations and very low memory requirements. So this is it. So questions, if you have questions.
And why do we have low memory requirements and low complexity? It seems like we need to invert matrices.
Look, so this is the low memory requirement for methods. Okay, so methods they do not need additional memory, like quasi-Newton or whatever schemes. Yes, so yes, indeed. So we need to compute this matrix by preprocessing, but again, so this is a standard operation in linear algebra, and in some sense, it is not our problem. So to have the sparse, factorization of positive definite matrix. So there are in linear algebra there are well studied cases where this inverse matrix and factorization of inverse matrix, so it has sparse structure. There are simple cases, and we can just use that. So in some sense, we do not add complexity of the problem by the optimization technique. Optimization technique doesn't require too much. So, but what linear algebra can do, so it can do. If not, so it is their business. We are not going to improve this too much. It is not our field. But from optimization point of view, here everything is simple. If you, for example, know from any other reasons that you have the good scaling for your subdifferential, you can use it immediately. It is not the optimization part.
Can we handle smooth optimization problems with relative accuracy framework?
Well, I do not have examples, actually. In some sense, of course, we can say that maybe we have this function differentiable. There are examples of homogeneous functions which are differentiable and so on. So why not? So that's. But no, I simply don't know. So I would start again from examples. So if you find the problem which is differentiable, it cannot be completely differentiable, you know, because at origin it should have kink, or I don't know. Maybe
example in statistics or machine learning, usually people do not need very high accuracy because they just introduce models by themselves.
Yes, and yes, this is true. We can look at that because actually, yes. First of all, you need to look at the model. So how? First, you need the functions for which you definitely have positive value, positive optimal value, and this knowledge should be transformed somehow to the knowledge for numerical schemes. So why this is so, and how you can model that, and all things like that. You need to start from the model of the problem. As you have seen, for example, in this presentation, the main examples for which we are able to do something, this is the maximum for absolute values of the formula, sum of absolute values. Yeah, it is indeed close to this machine learning stuff, and why not? Yeah. In some sense, it is not very. So you can. use this ellipsoid algorithm. So for arbitrary convex hull, so you have the, it's not necessary that it is symmetric. You can have several vectors like that, and you can have the ellipsoid inside. And when you see that the distance to this vector, to one of the vector, is big enough, you just look at this construction. And then, so you are trying to find the ellipsoid of the maximal volume, which belongs to this, how called, drop or whatever, so to this thing. And you stop if the distance to all these vectors is small enough. So from John theorem, you know that actually this alpha in the end must be proportional to n. But of course, maybe you can find something better. So finally, in the end of this algorithm, so you will have this estimate of the sphericity coefficients. But of course, you cannot say anything in advance because you have only bounds. So what is the actual sphericity? I don't know. Maybe indeed it is much better than we have from the John theorem.